वेलकम टू पार्टिकल प्रेजेंस प्रैक्टिकल सेशन। सो यू आर स्टडीज डिफरेंट टाइप ऑफ सर्टिफिकेट्स। इन प्रीवियस सेशन वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट सर्टिफिकेट्स फॉर रिगार्डिंग क्लियर एस्टिमेशन एंड फिजिकल एग्जामिनेशन। वी स्टडी व्हाट आर द इंस्ट्रक्शंस ऑफ इश्यूइंग एज ऑफ क्लियर एस्टिमेशन, how certificate is prepared, what is the importance of this certification and physical examination. That was all about the lead distribution. Now in today's session, we will discuss about the examination of lead victim, what are the instructions regarding examination of lead victim, and how examination is conducted, and how a report is prepared. So, starting with the instructions, obtain written consent for examination and collection of specimen of blood, etc., and to supply copies of all medical reports to the police. So it is important to take written consent of the examination. Always take written consent, not verbal consent. So written consent for examination purpose. For the collection of sample, any type of sample, maybe blood sample or urine sample or any specimen that is to be collected, or vaginal secretion, whatever the specimen is to be collected, written consent should be taken for that, and all the copies of all medical reports. What are the medical reports of examinations of different specimens, lab investigations, these should be supplied to the police. Next, with the importance for taking material from embryos and perineum. So, different specimens are collected in case of rape. So, the cotton swab should be used to collect material from embryos and perineum. Take material from lower part of vagina, posterior fornix, and cervical of using separate swab and make four slides and allow them to dry for 2 to 3 minutes and fix by. So with the help of cotton swab, sample should be taken from the uterus, perineum, from lower part of the vagina, posterior fornix, and cervical of using different separate swabs. So one swab used at one place should not be used to collect material or sample from another location. Separate swabs should be used, and four slides of each swab should be prepared. And these slides should be allowed to get dry, and that should be fixed by heat so further examination of that sample can be done. Next, keep one swab in test tube for acid phosphate determination. So the swab that is collected or that is used for the collection of specimen, out of these swab, one swab should be stored in or should be taken in test tube for acid phosphate determination. Next, insert a swab in a test tube containing small amount of normal saline and examine the glucose, mobile, and spermatozoa swab. So, one of the swab in test tube, one of the swab should be placed in a test tube containing saline water, and then it should be examined for the motile spermatozoa presence. Next, form pubic hair and place loose hair in labor canula. So, the pubic hair should be formed, and the loose hair that are present from pubic location, that should be placed in the envelope for the further examination. After collecting these loose hairs, a sample of 10 to 12 hairs, pubic hairs should be collected by cutting them and putting them in labor envelope. So, two different labor envelopes should be prepared. In one, loose hairs should be placed, and in another envelope, hairs that are cut from the pubic region should be placed. NaOH for bromine and DNA profile and 5 mm in sodium chloride for alcohol, drug and mental diseases. So blood sample should also be collected. These samples should be placed in 2 pot different vials, one plain vial and second vial containing sodium chloride. The plain vial is for the blood bromine and DNA profiling, and vial containing sodium chloride is for alcohol detection, drug detection and to diagnose any mental disease. Next, obtain fingernail scrapings and place in a label envelope. So fingernail scrapings should be collected and it should be placed in an envelope. As in case of rape, when the victim tries to tries to run, he scratches the body of the accused, and during that scratching, some of the tissues of the accused can retain into the fingernail grid of the victim, and that can help in the DNA profile and in finding the accused. So they should be collected, scraped, and should be collected in labeled envelope. Collect any loose hair or fibers found on the personal clothes. Again, same during the rape attempt or rape, they could be transferred some hairs of accused or fibers of clothes of accused on the body or victim. So that should be collected and should be placed in a labeled envelope for the further examination. Next, collect dried blood stains and indicate the site from which it is collected. Again, if there is any dried blood stain, that should also be collected and should be labeled, and it should also be labeled that from this site it is collected, as it may help in finding the accused if that blood is belonging to accused one. Next, collect material from cervix for gonorrheal infection. So, material from the cervix should be collected for the examination of mental disease like gonorrhea, whether infection is infection of gonorrhea or not. Obtain swabs from white mouse. In some cases, there will be white mouse, and from that white mouse, swab should be taken for the specimen. As again, in the case of rape, the accused may have given the victim, and this will leak the saliva of the accused on victim, and that can help in the DNA profiling. Again, will help in finding the accused. Next is preserved garments and suspected samples of blood stains after drying them. So the garments of the victim should be procured, should be collected and should be preserved after drying them. Then these clothes can help in the investigation and in the collection of specimen for the further examination. In most young women, a finger may be passed into vagina although the hymen is intact. So it is very important while the vagina is examined and persistence of hymen is examined, then in most young women, a finger may be passed into vagina although the hymen is intact. If the vagina opening is enough to admit 2 fingers easily, when the hymen shows old years, it indicates that the woman is used to sexual intercourse. So in young women, usually 1 finger can be inserted easily, but if the 2 fingers can be inserted in the woman vagina and hymen is not intact or it is showing old years, then it indicates that the woman is used to sexual intercourse. Now the procedure for examination. Informed consent. Consent of the victim should be taken in writing in presence of a witness. if she is above the age of 12 years. Again, it is a case of major and minor, who can give the consent and who can't. So in case of major, where the victim is above the age of 12 years, consent of the victim should be taken and it should be written and it should be collected in the presence of a witness. And in case of minor, if the victim is below the age of 12 years, then in that case, a written consent of the parents or guardian should be taken. Again, in case of mentally subnormal person, when cases where the victim is not mentally well, he is having some mental illness or he is mentally abnormal or subnormal, then in that case also, written consent of the parent or guardian should be taken. Section of 90 IPC states consent of insane person. If the consent is given by a person who from unsoundness of mind or intoxication is unable to understand the nature and consequences of that to which he gives his consent or consent of child, unless the quantity appears from the context, if the consent is given by a person who is under 12 years of age, not valid. So section 90 specifies that the written consent of the parent and guardian can be taken in different two types of cases. First case, when the consent is given by a person who is unsound of mind or who is intoxicated or is under the effect of a drug or is unable to understand the nature and consequences for which he is giving his consent, then in that case, or in case of child who is below 12 years of age, in these two cases, consent of the parent and guardian should be taken. Next, section 53, subsection 2 of CRPC, KVY said the examination should be made in the presence of a female nurse or a female relation unless the doctor is female. So section 53, subsection 2 of CRPC clearly states that in case when the patient or victim is female and the examiner is not a female, examiner is a male or the doctor is a male, then in that case a nurse, a female nurse should be there or a female attendant should be there who has a relation with the victim during the examination. Whenever female is to be examined, the examination should be made only by or under the supervision of a female registered medical practitioner. It should be tried that whenever female is to be examined. In that case, examination should be done by a female registered medical practitioner or under the supervision of a registered medical practitioner who is a female. So the principal features of the examinations are, first is preliminary criteria. Second is the statement of the victim and others separately. Third is sign of struggles on clothes and body. Fourth is examination of the genitals for local sign of violation, genital injuries, presence of discomfort of tumor and other microorganisms, and any evidence of STD. Next is collection of cavity specimen, then inference, and then advice on follow-up. So what are the principal features of the examination? A preliminary data should be collected regarding the information of individual, then the statement of the victim and others separately should be noted. What is the statement of victim is, what is the statement the person who has brought him or brought her to the center. All these statements should be recorded separately. Next, the signs of struggle of clothes and body. It should be examined that is there any sign of struggle on clothes. is there any sign of the violence or not? Is there any genital injuries? Is there presence of spermatozoa and microorganisms or any other evidence of STD? Next, collection of this laboratory specimen should be done. Different blood samples, different specimens, resemblance, swab, different swab should be taken. Then impedance should be drawn by the examiner. And then advice of follow-up. What advice is given of follow-up? It should be written. So first the statement of victim. In a word, it must be written down as much as possible, word for word. Word for word. It is very important that whatever the victim says, it should be written as it is said. In the language of victim, it should be written down. There should be no alteration or change in the language. The amount of violence used, the position of the assailant or accused, and the mode of attack should be elicited. It is necessary to inquire the assailant, owner or actor contact number. The first thing, during the statement of victim, it is very important that it should be written word by word. No changes should be there. Whatever victim says, it should be written in her own language. Next, the amount of violence used, the position of the assailant, and the mode of attack. That should also be taken down. It is very necessary to inquire that whether the designer or owner or panel or actor contact has been there or not. So it should also be mentioned there. Her statement should be noted with reference to pain, hemorrhage, sensation, rest of penetration, emission, and the appearance of discharge. If she cried for help or was too terrified to do so, she fainted. So whenever the statement is taken, it should be noted with the reference that there was a pain or not, there was a hemorrhage or not, sensation as to penetration, whether when she felt about the penetration and emission and the appearance of discharge, and whether she cried or not for the help, or she was too terrified to do so, or she got fainted due to that attack. Inquiry should be made on the events of the alleged assault. For example, if she has changed her clothing, part or past unit, any delay in making complaint to the authorities should have a proper explanation. A report should be made of the statement of others to accompany her. The degree of agreement of the various statements is important. So inquiry in this statement is very important. Whatever the victim said, it should be written in her own language, and different inquiries should be, or different information should be taken from the victim. So different inquiry about the different events of the alleged assault should be taken, like whether she had changed her clothes or not, or she had taken bath or not after this, or she had past urine or not, as it is very important. As you know that the blood clothes may contain the blood stains or the semen stains, or there will be some evidence regarding related to the assailant. So primary clues are very important, what she had wear during the rape. So was there any change or not, or she had bath, as the bathing may cause the removal of the evidences from the body, or whether she had passed the urine or not. If there is any delay in the making complaint, then a proper explanatory reason should be taken down or written down for such delay. A report should be made of statements of different persons who accompany her, who had brought her to the hospital, and the degree of agreement of various statements is very important. signs of struggles of throat and body. When examining the throat, it should be looked for a word of growth in the body. The clothing is rather seen as that worn at the time of crying. Should be examined in good light for evidence of the struggles, such as the end of pregnant, mass of mud or grass, or stain of dirt or semen. When clothes are torn, corresponding injuries to the body may be present and should be looked for. Mud and blood stains, when present, are generally seen on the back clothes, while seminal stains are seen on the front clothes. So during the examination, clothes and body of the examination should be examined very carefully, as it may help in finding evidences which are very important in the investigation of this crime. So whenever, if the patient has changed with the clothes which were worn during the act of crime, then they should be examined very properly. They should be examined in good light, so that any evidence present on that can be found. Evidences such as tear of clothes, blood stains, seminal stains, hairs, fabrics of clothes, or any mud or grass, or any foreign particle can be found on the clothes. When the clothes are torn, corresponding injuries to the body may be present and should be looked for. So in case of this crime, when the victim tries to get free herself, there may be some violence, and during this act of violence, the fabric may get got torn or the clothes may get torn, and there can be an injury which can be related to the area of which the fabric is torn. So they should also be looked for. Mud and blood stains when present are generally seen on the back of clothes, while seminal stains are seen on the front of the clothes. So usually blood stains and mud are present on the back side of the clothes, and seminal stains are present in front of the clothes. Stains may be found on the material, for example, handkerchief used for cleaning after the assault. Seminal stains can also be found on the handkerchief that was used for the cleaning after this crime. So when blood stains are seen, it must be ascertained if they are due to menstruation or not. If the blood stains are found, then it should be examined, or it should be ascertained that this blood stain belongs to the victim, or that this blood stain is due to the menstruation. On microscopic examination, so to ascertain the blood belongs to the menstruation or not, on microscopic examination, menstrual blood is found to contain endometrial cells from the uterus, epithelial cells from the vagina, and a large number of minor organisms which are not found in ordinary blood. Trichomonas vaginalis or monilia may be present. So to ascertain whether the blood belongs, blood is of victim or accused, or it is due to menstruation, a microscopic examination should be done. And if the blood is menstrual blood, then during the microscopic examination, endometrial cells, epithelial cells of vagina, and large number of microorganisms which are usually not present in the blood but are present only in the vagina or in the menstrual blood may be found. Along with these organisms and epithelial and endometrial cells, Trichomonas vaginalis or monilia may also be present if the victim is suffering from these diseases. Blood should be taken for grouping and DNA characteristics to determine if the stain belongs to the victim or ascendant. Once it is established that the blood stain is of menstrual or not, then it should be taken for the blood grouping and DNA profiling, so that it can be determined whether the blood belongs to the victim or ascendant. Seminal stain should also be grouped to ascertain subsequently if they match with the ascendant blood group. So once it is found that the bread from bread comes to retain or cement, if there is any seminal fluid, then it should also be examined for the DNA sequencing, so that you can be matched with the ascendant rate. The clothing should be retained carefully, dried, labeled and forwarded to the quality site regularly. So once the seminal fluid is also booked with the ascendant blood group, then the clothing should be retained and they should be sent to the forensic science laboratory for examination of suspicious stains, either blood, semen or bone. So this is all about today's session. We will continue this topic in the next session, and we will also discuss the performance of the examination in the next session. Thank you.